Jeff Sharlet, contributing editor, Harper's Magazine. Yeah, the family is the oldest and arguably most influential religious political organization in Washington. Dates back to the Great Depression in 1935, when the founder of this group had what he thought was a new revelation, that Christianity had been looking in the wrong direction for 2,000 years, focusing on the poor and the weak and the down and out, that God instead wanted him to work, God wanted to work through elites, through those whom he called the up and out, and that he should be a missionary to and for the powerful. And that's what the family has been ever since, concentrating not on mass revivals, but on organizing congressmen, businessmen, foreign officials, and today in Washington, the membership is comprised primarily of senators and representatives and government officials who are bound with this together in this idea that what they see as spiritual warfare, they call it sometimes, or religious change can best be affected through elites, not through mass movements. Elite fundamentalism is always going to be involved with a certain set of conservative interests, but certainly not exclusively Republican. And you know what's interesting about the family and why the family is a particularly useful group for going back and reviewing the history of conservatism is that while it's always been majority Republican, it's never been exclusively Republican. Back in the early days, there was a lot of the so-called Dixiecrats, the conservative pro-segregation Southern Democrats. Strom Thurmond was involved, Herman Talmadge, Absalom Willis Robertson, a senator from Virginia, and Pat Robertson's father. And today, I think what's interesting is the populist movement of fundamentalism is starting to mirror that approach that elite fundamentalism has long had of trying to, you know, have influence across the political spectrum, and understanding that when you do that, you can drag the whole political spectrum rightward. So the family's always been doing this, always cultivating certain Democrats, and I think now we're starting to see populist conservatives recognize that they were too tied to the Republican Party. So there's the Republican partisan activists, but then there's the real conservative sort of visionaries, for lack of a better word. They don't care who does the changes they want to see happen. They don't care if it's Senator Chuck Grassley standing in the door and blocking Obama's legislative changes, or if it's Senator Mark Pryor, a Democrat from Arkansas, who was arguably one of the key men in scuttling a big part of Obama's labor agenda. And in fact, I think they take great satisfaction from the idea that there's Democrats and Republicans involved, because to them, this is testifying to the sort of the universal truth of their cause. They say, in fact, what we're saying isn't conservative or liberal. It's not right wing or left wing. It's simply true. And all these Republicans know it, and a bunch of Democrats know that, too. Elite fundamentalism has always been on the corporate side of things. But what that does is tell us that these things, that this divide is not nearly so sharp as, you know, maybe David Brooks would have us believe, that there's some rabble out there and then there's some high-minded, proper Republicans. You know, the family begins as a Christian fundamentalist anti-labor organization. It begins with a bunch of bosses getting together and saying, we're going to break labor's spine and that we're doing this for Jesus. This is what Jesus wants. So it's the rhetoric that maybe that you're familiar with from the fights over abortion, but being applied to corporate interests in service of what the family in particular, but also other religious conservatives would come to call over the years biblical capitalism. The idea that capitalism is foreordained in the Bible, and that in as much as we interfere with the market, we're interfering with God's very literal and visible hand, God's ability to move the hearts of big business people and have them do the right thing. That instead of relying on government programs or labor unions or any kind of activism, we should rely on Jesus to move the hearts of these leaders, and that they will then dispense the blessings to the rest of us. So it's a sort of trickle down economics and trickle down religion. And that's influenced the shape of populist conservatism at this point, too. I mean, I remember a few years ago, I was in a mega church in Colorado Springs, Ted Haggard's church, before Ted Haggard's fall. Those were very prominent pastors, no longer so prominent after it came out that he was having a relationship with a male prostitute. But at the time, Haggard had managed to get the 11,000 or so members of his church all riled up over the issue of steel tariffs. Steel tariffs, that was the issue. Steel tariffs were violating God's plan. And these weren't wealthy people. These were mostly working class people. So that's that kind of trickle-down religion in action, and showing that you can recruit the populist conservatism for the interests of corporate conservatism, that the two things can be married into one unholy union. I think you have to put everything, we are still living in an era defined by the Cold War. The Cold War was really the great struggle of the 20th century, and it just shaped American political life from top to bottom. And what the Cold War did was provide a really fairly clearly defined enemy. And it's easy to organize around that. And what's interesting is, of course, not only did conservatives organize around that, liberals did too. Liberals were just as engaged in using the rhetoric of a battle with the Soviets and with communism in general, with an evil empire. There were plenty of Democrats who used the evil empire rhetoric as well. And this interesting thing happens with the collapse of communism, especially in the sort of the really activist ranks of Christian fundamentalism, which was really the base for conservative activism. Who's the enemy now? And so they've been sort of casting about now for some years, trying to figure out how to define themselves. And there was this actual moment I mentioned before, this church out in Colorado Springs, New Life Church, several years ago. They had it was a summit of about 3,000 pastors around the country. And the debate at the summit was, what is the front line of the struggle for America's soul, America's future? What is the great threat? Because you got to have a threat. And there were two choices. The gay man, you always hear this individual spoken of as in the singular, the gay man, like it's this one guy who is subverting everything. It's an archetype. Or the Muslim, the gay man or the Muslim. And that's been a tension in the right for a while now. And what I think is happening is it's slowly sort of coalescing around the side that would make struggle with Islam the main fight. And partly because that reproduces some of the alliances that were made possible by the Cold War. Because there's Democrats and there's liberals who are every bit as sort of anti-Islamic as the hard right is. There is the real, there are real radical Muslim groups out there that really are pretty villainous. You know, you don't have to make them up. But as they do that, that really, it replicates some of the Cold War, but it's not a perfect fit. And I think as they sort of struggle with that issue, it sort of explodes things outward. So you have this one issue, this sort of this Muslim threat. Well, that allows people to talk about national security. So you go to like a town hall or a Tea Party meeting, and you have folks talking about big government and so on, but also speaking in incredibly precise detail about America's missile arsenal and missile defense. And this becoming an issue, and linking that to the question, not just of healthcare, but of public schools. I mean, really, I think one of the overlooked struggles on the right now is the longtime dream of the eradication of public schools. which they're not ever going to, that's not going to happen, or at least anytime soon. But look how far they've come. You know, look how much that right word push has shifted the debate so that public schools are probably have less government support now than they have certainly in our lifetimes and going back many decades. So all these kinds of little issues that are somehow being linked to the great enemy and their mind of Islam, that Islam requires us to get our house in order. And our house in order means we need education that is going to teach about real menace, and public schools can't do that. It means we need this vigorous free market enterprise, and it's all for the sake of national security. Fundamentalism is a 20th century phenomenon, but that kind of religious fervor actually has not always been associated with conservative goals. And, as Christian right activists are quick to point out, they say, look, it was evangelicals who were on the front lines of the fight for abolition in the antebellum period. And that's true. I mean, and you even go back to the sort of the defining moment, the creation moment of a kind of modern fundamentalism, which is the Scopes Monkey Trial of 1925. You know, this is the evolution trial over whether or not we're going to teach creation in schools in Tennessee and so on. And we all have this sort of popular narrative of this event, Clarence Darrow as the great lawyer and champion of justice versus crazy William Jennings Bryan, the old fundamentalist and blustering on about the sun standing still and monkeys and all this kind of stuff. And that narrative obscures the fact that what happened in 1925 wasn't left versus right. It was two great strands of leftist thought in American life clashing. That up to that moment, William Jennings Bryan was the most successful populist presidential candidate in American history. Had a lot of ugly ideas, but had also a lot of very progressive ideas. He's a guy who leaves the Wilson administration because he sees it as too imperialist. And he represents a leftist tradition of fundamentalism that gets kind of lost at that point. Because I think liberals sort of coalesce around this other idea that we own reason, that we own the center, that we are the establishment. And so there's really nowhere else for that energy to go now but the right, because liberalism has for so long defined the establishment. And then you also have the problem that liberalism can't ever, it can own the center, but it can't ever mobilize the same energy. Who's going to go marching out in the street and say, you know, what do we want? Incremental reform. When do we want it? Over a graduated period of time. You know, it doesn't energize folks. It doesn't speak to the visionary aspect of American life. It doesn't speak to ideals. Liberalism doesn't speak to ideals. Radicalism does. Leftism does. And some other movements, you know, the once and former labor movement, there isn't much of a labor movement now, which wasn't exactly left, but it did speak to these sort of visionary ideals, and it was able to organize a lot of people. Even now, it's still able to organize a lot of people, just not nearly as many. She's a different story, but it's an old story. It's the George Wallace story. Maybe she's not so grand as George Wallace. Maybe it's the Lester Maddox story. It was the lesser George Wallace of Georgia. But it's also part of the whole history of the United States and conservatism with the United States of revival. Now, religious historians look at United States and say one of the things that makes it sort of unusual is this cyclical revival, religious revival. There's the first Great Awakening that before the United States is formed. There's a second Great Awakening. There's arguments, are we now in the midst of a third or fourth Great Awakening? If it's a fourth, when did the third end? But no one disputes that periodically throughout American history, there's been these great big revivals. These are obviously populist religious movements. And out of them, you see leaders like George Wallace, the famous populist sort of left-right governor of Alabama, or before him, Huey Long. again, is he left, is he right? It's hard to say. He's populist, but he certainly, both these guys in some ways tended to sort of consolidate power in a way that is very, very comfortable for elites, that elites have sort of encouraged this. Sarah Palin is the latest incarnation of this. And, you know, I think the question with Sarah Palin is not whether or not we're in this revival moment. You look at the Tea Parties and you look at the schisms within the establishment Republican Party and the broader conservative movement. There's no doubt we're in a revival moment. The question is Sarah Palin going to be the one who's going to be that standard bearer? Does she have the juice to become a George Wallace, or to become a Barry Goldwater, or to become something that, as you said, hasn't existed before? And there is potential for that too, I think, because the issues over which this populist movement gets excited are different than they were for Wallace or Long or going back further, Billy Sunday, not in the political sphere, but as a political religious revivalist. They're different issues at different times. It's possible that these fringe characters who we've traditionally understood as big fringe, but they end up sort of pushing the establishment one way or the other. I don't see any third parties coming, but there could be a real massive shift in what establishment means. Sarah Palin may not lead that, but she may just ride the crest of that wave. Or there may be, maybe she's opened the door for someone who is a little bit of a smoother operator. I remember a friend of mine, it was in France or Italy, I don't remember. He was sitting in a cafe and someone comes running down the streets yelling, "The professors are coming, the professors are coming," a rampaging mob of professors. Which I think liberalism wants to dismiss as extremism. But I prefer, my favorite forgotten president in American history is James Buchanan, who, in defending really robust and sharp-elbowed debate, says, "I like the noise of democracy. I like the sound of people in the streets making noise." Which is what's made it actually ironic that so many liberals have rushed to denounce these tea parties, these folks on the street, as somehow anti-democratic and mob violence and so on. Now, I don't agree with these demonstrations at all, but they're doing the work of democracy. They feel that their government's not responding to them. They're correct, and I hope it doesn't, but they're saying, look, we are going to make a lot of noise. And there's going to be sharp elbows. We're not going to go out and do this civilly and say, "Well, I disagree with you." That kind of keeping the conversation quiet, that always favors whoever's holding the power. Whoever's holding the power says, "Yeah, let's keep things civil and quiet." Whoever's outside says, "No, I'm not going to keep things civil and quiet. I'm gonna bang on the door." And I think that's. I think we may be in this moment, you know, I know we're talking about the future of conservatism, but what's interesting to me also is I think that there's a sense in which we're in, you know, maybe 1964 or 1963, that we could be also moving toward a period of radical revival as disillusionment with the Democratic Party sets in and as a generation of folks with just no attachments to the last great radical revival come up and to say, "Look, I'm pissed about this. And I don't care if Fox News is going to say I'm a 60s retread because I was born in 1985, so clearly I'm not." And I think that moment could be coming. I think they are sustainable. And when we talk about the future of conservatism, that's it. I mean, these parties are so consolidated now. The idea of a serious third party challenge is just kind of ridiculous and so on. That's the future of conservatism, the Democratic and Republican parties combined. The Max Baucus approach to healthcare, that's the future of conservatism. A government in the interest of a big business, essentially. But so the parties are going to stay put, but that doesn't mean politics are going to be defined by the parties. There's going to be a lot of stuff happening beyond that. And on the right now, there's all this stuff happening. What I've been interested in fact, is the real incredible just sort of kudzu-like growth of fundamentalism in the military. And that's a faction, that's something in play that hasn't been in play for a long time. It's one thing to have fundamentalist activists. It's another thing to have fundamentalist generals who are armed and who have decided that the time has come to redefine their oath to protect and defend the Constitution. I don't think we're in danger of any coups, but I've talked to enough senior officers who have lost hold of that traditionally pretty solid subordinate relationship between the military and civilian structure. There's no radical movement like that on the left, but there could be, and I think a lot of the political action, the political life of America is going to start happening outside of the parties. Thank you.